Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
If you're like me, you're perhaps a bit surprised at how pleasant it feels in here at the moment, given the warmer temps we've been having the last couple of days, and today's supposed to be quite the scorcher. So hopefully through the service it'll remain cool. We can crank the fans up if we need to. But thank you for joining us this morning on the third Sunday after Pentecost. Grateful that you're here. Folks online, thank you so much for tuning in. A couple of announcements as we get started. Draw your attention to the bulletin, and actually there are a few other things I wanted to include and just slip my mind, but I'm not going to go into any details. Most of it's right there in the bulletin, but one thing I did want to draw your attention to is the church's annual picnic. Again, I didn't get this in the bulletin. The church's annual picnic was going to be in early August. For various reasons, it's been moved to the end of July. So I think July 31st is the date that the deacons have settled on. And that's the time when our church will meet outdoors under the big tent. I'm assuming it'll be over at the food shelf. I need to connect with the deacons about some of those details. But we've got the big tent. I'll be over at the food shelf Sunday, July 31st. So mark your calendars for that. I'm assuming we'll have probably a potluck, even though it's the end of the month and not the beginning of the month. So, but more details to come. I think the conflict was something to do with Trace Diaz, perhaps. Maybe one of the men's weekend was the day that they had picked at the beginning, and obviously want to make room for people that feel moved to go to Trace Diaz. So that's that. Cyber camp, I've still got a few holes to fill. If any of you are interested in volunteering or playing a role in that camp, it is July 10th through the 14th. I think that's maybe in the... It's not in the bulletin, but it's on the link there. So July 10th through the 14th, it's a Sunday through a Thursday. If any of you are interested in helping with that, it's a really wonderful outreach that we do every year. And at the moment, we've already got about 45 kids pre-registered for that. And usually we have another dozen or more register last minute or just show up. So it's going to be one of our larger camps. So all hands on deck would be great to have some help with that. And we'll have a team from North Carolina that will be coming up to help play a role, so you'll get to meet some new folks, and maybe they'll even be able to join us for a church service or two. We'll see. And also, finally, before we really get into the real meat of why we're here, Young Lions, last week we kicked off our Sunday morning children's program called Young Lions, and so this is going to we really do desire that children also be a part of the larger worship upstairs. And so families that, for one reason or another, definitely if you've got kids, say 11, 12 and up, we welcome them here. So don't feel like this is a get your kids downstairs kind of thing, okay? That's not at all the heart behind this. We long for our kids to be a part of the church in every single way. But we know, especially with the little ones, sometimes it can be quite a challenge. And so we want to create some space for that. And so we're working on that with our Young Lions program. We want to teach the kids about prayer, about missions, local and foreign missions. We're going to teach them about Scripture and how to pray through Scripture. A lot of other wonderful things we're going to be doing. And I'm so grateful to Joanne and the others that have stepped up to help with this program. So that's called Young Lions. And it's going to be each Sunday for kids 5 to 11 downstairs for about half of the service. But there will be a break every Sunday on Communion Sunday. So, sorry, my words are getting choppy here. So the first Sunday of the month, we won't have the Young Lions program, is what I'm trying to say. But the other weeks of each month, we will. So again, that information's in the bulletin, but I want to continue to draw attention to that since it is fairly new. All right, without further ado, if you have any questions about that, see me or see Miss Joanne in the back. Miss Joanne, if you could raise your hand. Most of you know Miss Joanne. She's... heading up the program. So, all right, kids, come on in. Thanks. Amen. We will recite question and answer 5 out of our catechism this morning. Children, you can go ahead.
What else did God God created all things, and all his creation was very good. What else did God create?
Amen. Thank you, children. Well, folks, please stand as you feel moved and say hello to your neighbors. Please remain standing for our responsive call to worship out of Micah chapter 7. You will notice your words are in the bullets in the bulletin on the screen. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance?
He does not retain his anger forever, because he delights.
He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot.
He will cast all of our sins into the depths of the sea.
You will show faithfulness to Jacob and steadfast love to Abraham, as you have sworn to our fathers from the days of old. Amen. Let's pray together. O Lord God, as we turn to you now, we want to lift our voices in worship. We are here to adore you, to magnify your name. Lord, we know we are sinners. We so struggle, and we need your help. So I ask, God, this morning that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit, that we might praise you aright, that we might worship you in spirit and in truth. Be here, be glorified, touch each person this morning. May we leave this place changed after an encounter with you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Grateful to have Tim Frisch with us again this morning. Many of you know Tim, and he'll be leading us in worship. Thank you, brother.
How's everyone doing? Great to see you here. I'll be honest, I was pretty tired this morning, but what a pleasure to be able to come and worship with God in His strength. noticed in the reading this morning, the catechism reading, it was asked about God's creation. It says God created all things and his creation was very good. I noticed that past tense. That when God created the world, it was perfect, right? But it's not perfect, is it? Not today. And it says in Romans 8 that the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its slavery to corruption into the freedom of the glory of the children of God. We definitely live in a world with its problems, but what the scripture is teaching us is there is hope. There is hope, there's a future, and that is found in Christ. Do you feel the world is broken? We do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? We do. Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting?
Remember people in time, every nation in time.
Wow, great singing. I'm struggling with the piano playing on that, so your singing covered it really well. He is worthy of that. He is worthy. Beautiful. Thank you.
Jesus. We worship you this morning. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Thank you so very much. And Felicia, were we able to, as the missions moment, come out of court today? Okay. There's some problem with Dropbox. We're going to now turn to looking at a country. We do this once a month. Take a moment and ponder what's going on across the world so we can pray and just be in tune with our brothers and sisters across the globe. And the country we're going to look at, again, I don't know that I've got it in the bulletin, is Oman. Maggie's going to tell us a little bit about what's going on there. So go ahead, pull it up when you can, Felicia.
Good morning, Radio Brothers and Sisters. Greetings from Maggie's family in Vancouver. I'm sorry, something wrong with my video camera, so I had to hide myself behind the screen, but I really miss you guys. So this month, in the mission moment, we are going to talk about the country named Oman. Oman? Oman? How do you spell this country in English? In Chinese, we call it Oman, so it's quite different. However, let's take a close look at the country. Here, the country is in the Arabian Peninsula area. As you can see, where the heart is, and the Israel is over here, nearby the Mediterranean Sea, and here is the Africa. So, located in such area, you will know the experience of Christians in Oman are really facing a high challenge. So let's take a close look at that. So what does the persecution look like in Oman? Omani nationals who convert from Islam to Christianity encounters the highest level of pressure from both their families and their surrounding societies. And Omani believers may be kicked out of their families, homes, and lost their jobs, and lost their wives and husbands and children. And they can also lose custody of their children and be stripped of their inheritance. As foreign Muslims is another group of people, but most of them, they are migrant workers. If they are converted into Christianity, normally they will experience the same pressure they would have in their home countries. While the others, from different religions, they might have different relative freedom as well. So it's quite severe of the Muslim Christians. So the church facilities is another thing. Let's say Christian communities are mostly tolerated, but church facilities are restricted and Christian meetings are monitored to record at the political statements and to see if any Oman nationals are attending. All religious organizations must be registered with the authorities. And I know some missionaries there, Chinese missionaries, and they can freely worship. However, they cannot have the local people there. And as soon as they were found, the church might face very severe persecution. What has changed this year? We know everything is changing with the pandemic and everything. The persecutions there are increasing. Many people, they're facing different challenges, and especially Christians converted from Islam to Christianity came under higher pressure after Omani government intensified its monitoring of Christians and their activities. So let's pray for Oman. There are so many Christians in Oman come from other countries and live and work as migrant workers. Pray for those believers that they will be able to find a community base and know they aren't alone, even if they are converts from Islam or another faith. And that's asked God to challenge, to change the hearts of the sultan and the leaders in Oman. We know God can do everything, including reaching the tribal leaders of Oman with the hope of the gospel. So let's never lose that single hope. And when an Arab Muslim finds Christ Jesus, it can cost him or her everything. Ask God to bless those converts, preserve their safety, and bring believers into the path so that they will help them in spiritual growth. And the last prayer request is, please pray for the missionary Lee. Personally, I know him, and he's working in those areas. And he's contacting me recently, so he's going to start a migrant worker ministry in that area. So please keep him and his ministry in your prayer. And what he's going to do is open a kind of cafeteria area so that they can help more Christians to find a job there and also become a place of sharing the gospel. Thank you. Thank you for your prayer, and let's pray, especially for the next month, from time to time for this country. Thank you. We miss you. Bye-bye. God bless you all.
So let's do that now. Let's take just a moment and pray. Lord, we thank you for Maggie taking the time to put together that presentation. We come and lift up these precious souls in Oman. We pray, God, that you would draw many to yourself. You would be at work. We pray for those that are suffering because of their testimony, what you've done in their life. Protect them. We pray for this missionary gentleman that Maggie mentioned. We ask that perhaps a couple, perhaps that you would God, help them with this migrant ministry work that they're seeking to do, to set up some kind of a cafeteria space where they can share the gospel with migrant workers. So we lift them up to you and pray that you would establish the work of their hands and give them success in this endeavor, and that we would see some come to know you through that important work. Thank you so very much for hearing our prayers. It's in Jesus' name we pray all these things. Amen. Now we'll turn to God's Word and hear an Old Testament reading out of the Psalter. And I'm going to invite Marilyn Lambert to read again. This will be Psalm 16 this morning that we'll be in. And we'll do the whole Psalm. Thanks, Marilyn.
Good morning. Preserve me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. I have no good apart from you. As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones, in whom is all my delight. The sorrows of those who run after another God shall multiply. Their drink offerings of blood I will not pour out or take their names on my lips. The Lord is my chosen portion and my cup. You hold my lot. The lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Indeed, I have a beautiful inheritance. I bless the Lord who gives me counsel. In the night also my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord's way before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my whole being rejoices. My flesh also dwells secure. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol or let your Holy One see corruption. You make known to me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
That psalm flies in the face of those assumptions that many make, and perhaps even some of us, right, struggle with, that knowing God is this stodgy, cold, fulfilling, satisfying kind of thing. No, here we hear in this section of Scripture, in your presence there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
Amen.
Right? God is good, and he brings us delight. And let's pray that he would continue to delight our hearts this morning as we continue to worship and pray to him. So now this we will transition into a time of prayer. We'll confess our sins to the Lord, but I want to let those who have young ones that might want to go downstairs, we'll dismiss them now. Children that are ages 5 to 11, and the older ones can go down as well, but we invite them to help and to be helpers to Miss Joanne and Barbara, who'll be down there this morning. And the rest of us will remain up here, and we'll take a moment to go to the Lord in prayer. We'll confess our sins. And then I'd like to say just a few words, perhaps, about this monumental Roe versus Wade Supreme Court ruling, which happened on Friday. But let's confess our sins to God. All of us together, and then we'll hear God's word of pardon. Cleanse me from my secret faults, O Lord, and forgive those offenses to your servant, which he has caused in others. I contend not in judgment with you, who are truth. I fear to deceive myself, lest my sin should make me think that I am not sinful. Therefore, I contend not in judgment with you. For if you, Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who shall stand? Amen. It's a prayer of Saint Augustine. Now hear the words of pardon as we confess our sins to God. Be reminded of God's word to you out of Psalm 34, verse 8. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Amen. Well, as we move into a time of prayer together, I would like to just take a couple of minutes to reflect very, very briefly on this massive, monumental Roe versus Wade Supreme Court ruling on abortion. I think it would be foolish for a pastor to just pass over and ignore something so large and massive as this. As people of faith who live according to the truth of God's word, although we recognize the many challenges of unplanned pregnancy, we do celebrate this ruling and believe it is the result of decades of prayer and advocating for the unborn. The overturning of Roe versus Wade represents God's heart for the unborn, and this decision will affect the spiritual climate and future of our nation. I do believe that. And hopefully in a very, very good way. This is a time for the church to shine with humility, okay? With gratitude and with grace. Let's not miss our moment by reacting to those who disagree with us in gloating or boasting or in any other inappropriate way over this ruling. Let us be a people filled with grace and humility. Like never before, this is a time for the church to serve, to pray, and to step up in the areas of adoption, foster care, and supporting every woman who is facing the decision of abortion, or perhaps an unplanned pregnancy, or a situation that she perhaps did not want to be a part of. This is a time for every believer to be equipped and ready to give a biblical and loving response to all those who see this differently, right? Who oppose your beliefs or ask you where you stand on the issue. And perhaps there's various nuances of this even in this room here. And finally, this is a time to pray, time to be in prayer about all of these things. And I want to suggest a few things to pray for. There was some emails flying around yesterday afternoon, a group of pastors in the area about these things, and these are some of the prayer requests that were mentioned in these emails. Let's pray for peace and for healing. Some groups are already calling for violent protests. Let's ask God to protect our justices, our government officials, pregnancy care center staff, and pro-life organizations across the nation. Pray for the pro-abortion advocates who are now struggling with anger, rage, confusion, and fear. Let's be in prayer that God would bring peace to their hearts. Pray for our state legislation. Pray for our lawmakers in our states, right? That God will give them wisdom and strength to enact laws to protect children in the womb. You know, Vermont, at this current moment allows for abortion right up to the very moment of birth, as far as I'm aware. Let's pray that that would change. That would be our desire. Pray also for wisdom and family-friendly policies that help support pregnancy, children, and their parents. And let us be willing to do our part, okay? Whatever that might look like. Some of you have brought children into home. Some of you have supported. Our church supports the work of the Pregnancy Center, not too far from here down in White River Junction. Let us do our part. And we pray for courage for God's people, right? This Supreme Court ruling is a result of many people standing for God's truth for decades concerning the sanctity of life. Ask him to continue to embolden his people to remain faithful to his word in all areas of life, no matter what our culture says. Okay, so pray for boldness and courage. And let's also, as these things come up, be quick to offer the forgiveness and grace of the gospel to women who have been in a difficult position, perhaps, and made a decision to have an abortion. Let's not be put down our noses or condemn. Let us be people that are grace-filled when we encounter folks that are dealing with these, with perhaps guilt or anger or bitterness over all of this. So now I invite us to do that. Let's take a moment together. Let's pray, okay? And what I would like to do is something a little different this morning. I just want to encourage you there in your seats. Maybe turn, if you're with the family, turn to the person next to you and just pray together. Pray silently if you're alone or you're not comfortable with praying with the person next to you. Again, if you're with family or whatever, whatever you feel comfortable with, but take a moment and let's just pray over these things. I've given you a couple prayer requests. Peace and healing for changes in our state legislation and for courage for God's people. So you guys go and just take a minute or two and do that there in your seats, and then I'll call us back and we'll pray together as a family. I invite you folks at home to do the same as well. Lord God, we lift these requests to you, these burdens. We live in divided time, but what an opportunity at this present time do we have to be the church. And I pray that we would not just gather on Sunday morning and speak the words, and churchy words, but that we would be the church and live and act and move in ways that are true to our calling as it's laid out in your word, God. Let us be people of peace, people of healing,
people who pray for our lawmakers, we're not combative, that we're not pursuing change in a destructive way, that our ways, our words, our heart, our actions would be life-giving. It would be consistent with our stance for life. Help us, O Lord. We pray for courage for all of God's people. And Lord, many other things we could lift up this morning, but that was one massive, big thing that happened this past week, and which will have ripples. Just as Roe v. Wade has had ripples over the previous 50 years, and some 62, 63 million children have been aborted in that time. We know that this will have ripples, this decision as well. We pray that those ripples would be in the long run, maybe not in the short run, they might not be, but in the long run, that they would promote human flourishing and thriving in this land. That is our heart's desire. That is our sincere prayer. And let us, in the way we live and speak, also be people that pursue and promote human flourishing, from the most vulnerable to the oldest, to the strongest. Lord, we want to lift up those here this morning and those that are tuning in, those that aren't with us. Lord, all the burdens and cares that we are carrying, we know there are many. There are many hardships right now as gas prices continue to soar, come down just a little bit in the past week or so. But as gas prices continue to rise and prices of everything continue to rise because everything is trucked and everything is shipped and everything depends on gas, Lord, there's a lot of fear, a lot of need as well. Many people stand in great need right now. And so Lord, we want to pray, again, for us to be the church, for us to be people who put our full trust in you, that we would not shy away from continuing to give to your church, that we would not shy away from continuing to open our hand to those in need, that we would not shy away from holding this world loosely, Lord. Let us live in such a way that really models to people in a time of need that we would be generous. Oh Lord God, provide for your people. Supply all our needs out of your glorious riches in Christ as you've promised. Thank you that you hear our prayers. God, we do look to you in this hour in every way. All these things and many others we could pray, we lift up to you in the name of the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you for praying. So much running through my head this morning. It's hard to sort through it all. There's so much to pray about and think about. And, so thank you for being a part of that little exercise. I hope that was a blessing to you. Well, as we turn in our Bibles, I want to invite you to turn to 1 Peter 3 this morning. It's on page 1205 in your Pew Bible. And while you turn there, I just want to say a few quick things. First, this is a controversial passage, okay? And you'll see that right on the surface there. It's a passage about husbands and wives. And I just want to offer a few thoughts before we come to the passage and really try and open it up this morning. Some of you are single. Don't tune this out, okay? Some of you have never been married, or perhaps some of you are widowed or widowers. Perhaps you're divorced and have not been remarried. That's okay. There's still something here for you. If you don't have a wife, don't have a husband this morning, I invite you to listen closely to the Word of God. For those of you who are married, Some of you will say amen to what Peter says here this morning, while others may have more trouble and be tempted to grumble, or some perhaps even scoff at the words that are here in our passage. Whatever your perspective, I just want to invite you to pause as we come to this passage and acknowledge that every single one of us here is influenced by our cultural context. We are all influenced by our context. This age in which we live has influenced us, for better, for worse. And as we come to the scriptures, I just want to urge you to allow the words here to speak. I'm, of course, going to do my best, my part, in letting them speak. Hope I don't get in the way. Sometimes I know I do. Some of us are going to be tempted immediately to write these words off or explain them in such a way that, in our minds, that there is basically no impact. But if we read our Bibles in that way, in such a way to where everything is explained just so that it fits us, I don't know that we're reading the Bible right.
Correct?
Things here never challenge us. We're probably not reading it right. If our faith never upsets us, then our faith is probably made in our image, not in God's image.
Amen.
I just want to say those words as we come to a difficult passage that likely will land on many of us in very different ways. So I'm going to invite Tim Miller forward, and as he comes, I'm just going to pray. Let's pray. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, or stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He will be like a tree that is planted next to streams of water, will never cease to yield its fruit, and its leaf will never wither. Oh Lord, let us be like that. Let us be those trees this morning. Let us be a people who love your word and treasure the teaching that's there for us. We look to you. Bless the reading. Bless the preaching. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good
morning.
Good morning.
1 Peter 3, 1 through 7. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives. When they see your respectful and pure conduct, do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair and the putting on of gold jewelry or the clothing you wear, but let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. For this is how the holy woman who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, by submitting to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. And you are her children, if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. Likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that your prayers may not be hindered. The grass withers, the flowers fade.
The word of God sustains the earth.
Karate chopping back there. That's great. I love it. Thank you, Tim, for that reading. Well, this is one of those topics that makes the preacher sweat a little bit, and it always elicits. And always elicits a wide range of responses. And as I have already appealed to you, let's do our best this morning to allow God's word to speak to us, despite the other voices that are clamoring for our attention and acceptance today. Again, this passage is going to land on us in different ways, not only because we're different people, but because we're in different stages of life and because we have different experiences. Some of you have had really terrible marital experiences. Abuse, adultery, abandonment. Perhaps you've been through a really difficult divorce. Maybe your husband or wife is in prison and you wonder what this passage means for you. I know a woman in that position, actually. That's hard stuff, and it may impact how this passage sounds to you. I just want to acknowledge that as we move in. Some of you have grown up in homes where this kind of marriage was foreign. Perhaps it didn't fit the mold that Peter is casting for us this morning. Perhaps it was a home with only one mom, or just a dad, or maybe it was grandma, or an aunt, or an uncle, or a single parent, you get what I'm trying to say, that raised you. Maybe all of you remember strife, maybe, or all you remember perhaps is strife in the home, right? Mom didn't have help, dad didn't have help, or perhaps the parents fought constantly. That's also very hard stuff that may impact how this passage sounds to you. Let me say here at the outset that all of those things are not the way it's supposed to be. Okay? God made marriage to be a beautiful picture of the kind of love that He has for His people. It's supposed to be a place where children thrive and where mom is protected and cherished and where dads lead out and are respected. It's supposed to be a place where there is order and where there is love and respect. Today, many, many marriages are not that. In fact, marriage has fallen into such ill repute today that a great number of people are simply foregoing it altogether. In 1960, some 72% of all adults in America were married. It was, for many, at that time, the thing you most wanted in life. For many people, you aspire to meet the love of your life, settle down, marry, maybe have children. Not anymore. Many people are foregoing marriage altogether. And one article I was reading earlier this week said, quote, "We are nearing a time when there will be more unmarried adults in the U.S. than married ones," end quote. It was hard to find a really recent statistic, but that same article said that nearly 40% of American adults are neither married nor living with a partner as of 2019. 40%. A lot of people. We could go on and on and on about all the reasons for that, but certainly one of them would be, I think we'd all agree, disillusioned. Many of these people have had a very bad experience in one way or another and just simply choose not to be married because of that. Rather just avoid the whole mess. Right? Maybe some of you are in that boat, or maybe you know someone in that boat, and you'd rather just not go through the whole thing, or they just rather not go through the whole ordeal. Let me say that all of these things are the fault of sin, not marriage. Sin is the enemy here, not marriage. Sin distorts, destroys, corrupts, and ruins everything that it touches. Last time I was down in North Carolina, my mom got out some of my old architectural drawings. I was an architecture student in college for the first semester I was there, and then I decided to focus more on baseball and let go of the whole architecture dream. But she brought out these drawings and wanted to know if I would take some of them back home to Vermont with me. And as I flipped through one of my sketchbooks, some of the drawings were hardly recognizable. In the 20-plus years since I had made the drawings, they had become smudged and didn't look as crisp and sharp as they did when they were created. Some of them were not much to look at. Now, it would be silly to look at all those drawings and base your opinion on the artist's ability, in this case me, because the drawings were smudged. I said, "That guy's a terrible artist. Look at that mess." It would be even more foolish to abandon drawing altogether or to condemn art altogether because a few pieces were smudged. Marriage was created pure and beautiful by God in the beginning, yet sin has crept in and made it but a shadow of what it was before. It's destroyed our ability, our experience, and even our ideas about marriage. So some of my reason for saying all this as we start is just to acknowledge that right on the front end, right? Let's just
be aware of this as we move into this passage, just to acknowledge that pain that is there for so many. Yet also let us not think that we are the first in history to deal with these sorts of challenges. Okay? So I think we have perhaps sometimes this idea, we can be really, what's the word, time-centric, right? We think that our time and place is the best or whatever. We see everything else through that lens. Let's not be that way. Let's recognize that challenges have existed across history in marriage. And here in our passage today, Peter writes, in part precisely because these followers of Jesus were facing similar struggles. Marriages were being strained to the breaking point in Peter's day as well. So he wants to write with some counsel and give some wisdom and direction. And what he's going to say is similar to what he said to us last week when we looked at our relationship to the civil government. Now, some of you were here, some of you were not. That's okay. I'll do my best to sort of make the connection. Basically, Peter is going to say that all of us are under authority of one kind or another, and how we relate to those authorities reflects upon our Lord. If you remember last week, he talked about submitting to every institution for the Lord's sake. He used that expression, and the same idea is coming through today. Last week, God said to us through Peter, be subject for the Lord's sake to every institution. He mentioned the civil government and said we are to honor them and respect them and even obey them until they command us. Some of you will remember us talking about this, until they command us to violate God's command. And at that point, we're obligated to disobey because we submit to a higher law and authority. He said something similar to servants with their masters. We didn't focus on that part last week, but he says something similar there. Even if they're cruel, he says, servants should honor their masters inasmuch as they're able. Now notice how at the start of our passage, the very first word there in verse 1 of chapter 3 is what? Likewise. And some translations have wives, likewise. But in the Greek, the first word is likewise. Some translations have in the same way. And his point is that those principles that we saw last week are going to apply in the marriage relationship as well. And this other authority and submission structure in marriage. And here's the big idea I want to try and get across this morning. Since a husband and wife are both under God's authority, they must seek to reflect that in the differing ways they relate to one another. Husband and wife are called to relate to one another in some ways in similar fashion, but in other ways, very different ways. Since a husband and wife are both under God's authority, they must seek to reflect that in the differing ways they relate to one another. And that sounds like a mouthful. Hopefully it'll make sense as we go along. So contrary to what our culture is inclined to think, marriage is not just about love, and it's not to be whatever we want to make it to be. God has a design in marriage, and how we relate to our spouses reflects upon Him, upon His character, His nature, who He is. Man and woman are equals, co-heirs of the grace of life, which Peter says at the end of our passage today, yet they have differing roles and responsibilities in the marriage relationship. This is one reason why Peter takes time to address them separately. He just assumes this fact. Wives, you to do this. Husbands, you're to do this. Some of you will notice that Peter devotes 6 verses to speaking to the wives and only 1 to the husbands. Now, before you say, Peter's a chauvinist, right? This is a chauvinistic teaching. Peter's picking on women, giving them the long laundry list of instructions and basically just excusing the men. Go about your way, boys. It's all right. Let me point out a couple of things before we say that in our minds here, okay? First of all, there are other famous marriage passages in the New Testament which lay the weightier and heavier burdens upon the men. Ephesians 5 is a classic example. In that passage, Paul likewise calls wives to submit to their husbands. But in that passage, the husband is called to do what? To die. To be like Jesus and give of himself completely to his wife, as Jesus did for the church.
So while Peter gives some unbalanced attention here to women in this passage and seems to burden them more than the men with all these instructions and a very difficult calling to submit to a sinful person, there are places in the New Testament where men are being given the greater, weightier burdens. Second thing I want to point out is this, and this is very interesting, and I hope you'll take note of this. The literature of the day, of Peter's day, when he was writing the first and second century, the literature of that time and place typically ignored the subordinate partner in a relationship. It's totally ignored them. One scholar writes this, quote, "Authors, when they wrote, addressed governors, masters, husbands, and fathers, and overlooked completely ordinary men, slaves, wives, and children, who were judged unworthy and incapable of receiving instruction." End quote. It's pretty rough, you know, from our perspective, right? So Peter actually here elevates the status and the importance of women merely by addressing them. Merely by addressing them. He honors the women of the churches and gives them even more attention to them here in this passage than he does the men. This would have been very countercultural to do. It would have been shocking, noticeable that Peter would even refer to the women in this writing. It would have been deeply felt by the original audience of the time. So let us lay aside all that to say that these assumptions that Peter's being, you know, chauvinist and so on and so forth, let's lay those things aside. Those thoughts that, you know, Peter's picking on the women and so on, because the original audience would have felt honored by Peter devoting such significant space to their instruction. Okay, so now here, what I want to do from here, before we get into the meat of the passage, I want to ask once again that question that I've been asking a lot since we started this little book. And my goal here, again, is not just go on and on and on with all these, you know, details. My goal really is to help try and give us a sense of what's happening in the book at large. So we can see it's a connected whole and that there is a logic and sense about why these things are being mentioned. But I want to ask that question, why is Peter writing these words here and now at this point in the passage? Why does he suddenly go into a diatribe seemingly on wives and husbands and how they should be relating to one another? Well, partly, of course, we assume there's some kind of problems, right? So that would be the immediate assumption there, but there's more to it than that, and we've kind of already answered the question a little bit, but it's good again to repeat things over and over, hopefully that it will stick and we will remember some of this as we go on. But what has Peter been calling his audience since the very beginning of this letter? What's he been calling them, that title that week after week after week we keep coming back to? Elect exiles, right? They are exiles, they are strangers, they're aliens, they're foreigners, pick your choice word or adjective. Over and over again, he has emphasized this, and we've seen how this might lead one to think that because they are a citizen of another country, right, I'm a foreigner here, my home is in heaven, I don't belong here, because of that correct teaching, that might lead to an incorrect application, which says, I don't have to listen to anything here, I don't have to follow the emperor, I don't have to listen to the laws because I, you know, follow a higher law, a God that's in heaven. I don't have to obey the rules and customs of the country that I live in, and so on. This might be a kind of logic that might follow from thinking this is not my home. And Peter says this kind of thinking is wrong. Again, we looked at this in detail last week. This is wrong, he says, because all of those institutions and structures, those authority structures, were put in place by God and are for our good. So we must, in as much as we can, honor them. Our earthly authorities are not to be thrown off simply because we call Jesus king. Right? We don't throw off the earthly king because we call Jesus king. However, here's the tricky part. What happens when outsiders who do not call Jesus king learn that you do call him king instead of their leader? Instead of their czar or emperor or, you know, sultan or whatever. They're going to view you as a potential threat or an enemy, right? This is a natural reaction. The Christian is seen to be disrespecting the leader or the emperor when they refuse to worship him. The Christian wife, and here's the big connection I think that Peter's making here, The Christian wife seems to be dishonoring her husband because she refuses to join the worship of his deities, and so on. So many couples, right, were coming to faith, but others were not. Where the wife or just the husband was coming to faith, and there were these divided homes. And Peter is writing to say, guys, this is what you need to do in that case. At that time and place, it would have been shocking for a woman to have a different religion than her husband. If the husband converted to Christian faith, the wife and the children would almost inevitably follow. That's why you see a lot of household baptisms. And sometimes you'll see a woman come to faith and the household be baptized as well. But as a general rule, if the husband came to faith, the family did as well. But not as a rule the other way around. This is why Peter only mentions in this passage husbands who do not obey the word in verse 1. And does not give the same instructions to men. Presumably, that situation very rarely arose. Because of this, Peter puts stress here on the need for respect, especially with the wives, because this was one of the authority structures designed by God and put in place for our good, and it was to be honored. And a woman who is not perceived to be submitting to her husband, and even in his faith and religion, would have been seen as rebellious. So that is a part of why I believe Peter is writing these things. And many scholars certainly would agree. So now let's look into the meat of the passage and think a bit more about these things together. I'm going to repeat the big idea again for us. There's a lot here. I'll do my best to get through this. So listen carefully. Since a husband and wife are both under God's authority, they must seek to reflect that in the differing ways they relate to one another. And what I want to try and do here is to give four ways that both wife and husband reflect their submission to God. Again, I want to be mindful of the fact, just as we did with the civil authorities, yes, we honor the earthly authorities, but we do so because we are under a higher authority. So both husband and wife, in different ways, submit to that higher authority in these different ways. So first we're going to look at the wives. Again, I've got 4 points for each. Point number one for the wives. And I'm going to go through these fairly quickly. This first one will be the longest. Point number one for the wives. The wife reflects that she is under God's authority when she is subject to her own husband. Not to someone else's husband, to her own husband. Now I can't remember if I shared this example with all of you, but not long ago I went out to eat with our friends from Kenya that were visiting. They were here a month ago, almost exactly to the day. And we went out to eat. We went to a restaurant, sat down, and got our food, and I asked if everything was okay. And Tim was with me. And after judging from their reaction, I got the impression that perhaps something was not okay. So I kind of explored that. And I soon realized that okay to them meant like, excellent, top-notch, the very best. So when they were hesitant to say so, I thought maybe there was a problem. In their culture, to say that something is okay, you would say, so-so. Like that would be their way of saying that. And after a few moments of clarification, we settled on the word good. Everything was good. It's not the very best they'd ever had in all of their life, but it was good. Not the greatest, again, but good. So words, my point is, words can mean different things, even simple words like okay. In verse 1, we find this word submit or be subject to, and we read it today in a very negative way. We talked about this last week. We think of this idea of like a wrestler bringing its opponent, his or her opponent, into submission, right? That's kind of what we think about, against their will. And part of the reason that we are offended by this word submit or submission is because authority has been so terribly abused in our culture, many cultures, but in ours as well. We think of the abomination of slavery and the abuse of many men towards their wives has created an understandably intense skepticism towards the word submission. We could give other examples of that. But God's design for marriage is beautiful, and we should not throw it out because of poor examples, even if they abound. So wives, let me say, submission is not a lesser position. This is a huge misunderstanding of the word submission, biblically, and what is being said here. Was Jesus Christ less than the Father? All of our historic creeds and confessions state this plainly, that Jesus was co-equal with the Father, yet he submitted to the Father's will. Listen to the Athanasian Creed written in the 4th century. For the person of the Father is a distinct person. The person of the Son is another, and that of the Holy Spirit still another. But the divinity of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit is one. Their glory equal, their majesty co-eternal. They are equal. Equal in value, worth, majesty, glory. Yet Jesus Christ is over and over and over again in the Scriptures said to submit to the will of the Father. Submission does not imply that a woman is lesser. Far from it. So wives, do not chafe under this calling. It is a burden, yes, and a challenge, yes, undoubtedly. But know that this does not hide your worth or dignity. It expresses it. This is the woman's unique way to model Christ, who submitted to the Father's will and plan, even though he was fully God and fully equal with the Father. Ultimately, wives, your submission to your husband is a submission unto the Lord. And because of that, your submission to your husband has limits. So hear this part, okay? Clearly, it has limits. He is not God. Amen. I was expecting some amens. So, far from it, right? He's a sinful man, as many of you wives out there well know. And as we discussed last week, just as the civil government's authority has limits and our submission to it has limits, so it is in the marriage covenant. We do not submit to a government that demands us to sin. A woman does not submit to a husband that demands her to sin. Her first love and first devotion belong to Jesus, not her husband. So let that be said. Nonetheless, it is God's will that a woman seek to honor her husband by being subject to him. That's point number one. And that's the longest of the ones. So now with the subsequent points, we can see a bit, perhaps, of what that looks like. Okay, so maybe we're thinking, what does this look like? Well, Peter's going to give us a little bit of a sense of what some of this might look like. Point number two. A wife reflects that she's under God's authority when she does not seek to prevail upon her husband with her words. Her husband doesn't want to do something, isn't feeling something. It is not godly for a woman to continue and continue and continue to get on him with her words. This is, again, what the Word of God says. This is what we see in the latter half of verse 1 and in verse 2. Likewise, wives, be subject to your own husbands, so that even if some do not obey the word, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives, when they see your respectful and pure conduct. As we've already seen, a woman who does not adopt the faith of her husband would have been seen as rebellious at the time. She might be tempted to persuade him into the kingdom with many words, right? Trying to persuade him, maybe with guilt or verbal manipulation. These are not appropriate and, in fact, may only push her husband further away from the kingdom. While Peter does say, without a word, he most definitely does not mean that a wife is to be mute and never speak. Sarah, the woman Peter lifts up as an example in this passage, spoke to her mind to Abraham. There are examples of this in the Old Testament. We go to Genesis 21. She speaks her mind to Abraham, and he listens and complies with her. Peter's point here is that the wife's words will likely not be the deciding factor in bringing an unbelieving husband into the kingdom, though there are exceptions, of course. The wife's words will likely not be the persuasive piece. She is better equipped to draw her husband into the kingdom through the use of her other gifts and callings. Often a wife will find it better if another, someone outside the family, shares the gospel and speaks of the faith with her husband. I know this has been the case in some of my close friendships with couples. Again, there are exceptions. So what then is a woman to do if she finds herself in this situation, perhaps? Well, this leads us to point number three. Point number three for the wives. A wife reflects that she is under God's authority when she adorns herself with a gentle and quiet spirit, right? So the idea here is, okay, if I can't persuade him into the kingdom and share many, many words with him and bring him in, well, what am I to do? Verses 3 and 4 here. Do not let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair, the putting on of gold and jewelry, or the clothing you wear, but let your adorning be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which in God's sight is very precious. The problem here, again, is not with braided hair or jewelry per se. And at that time, and in some cases today as well, elaborate hair would have taken hours to prepare. It would have been a big ordeal to get all the hair ready and the external adornment ready. It would have drawn lots of attention to those details that are not as important to the Lord. Remember the Lord's words to Samuel in 1 Samuel. Chapter 16, but the Lord said to Samuel, don't judge by his appearance or height, for I have rejected him. The Lord doesn't see things the way you see them. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. 1 Samuel 16. A woman who cultivates the inner beauty that is precious to God demonstrates that she is his child and servant, and that her values are not determined by the world, but by the Lord. This will speak louder than words to her husband, Peter says, and brings honor to God. And there's a great deal of truth in this, too, for you single women out there who hope perhaps one day to be married. Do you want a man who loves you for your looks? Hopefully he will and does find you attractive, but there's more than that, right? Or do you want a man who sees deeper than merely the external things? Peter says there's great value in that. The internal beauty. Point number four for the wives. A wife reflects that she is under God's authority when she does not fear anything that is frightening. Verses 5 and 6. For this is how the holy women who hoped in God used to adorn themselves, by submitting to their husbands as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you are her children if you do good and do not fear anything that is frightening. What do we do when we are afraid? One very common reaction to fear is control, manipulate. That's what we do, all of us. When we're afraid, we'll often try and control the situation to mitigate the impact of the thing we're afraid of. Perhaps these women were afraid that their husbands would abandon them since they had not embraced their faith. These women perhaps feared the incredible isolation that would have been represented at the time when men were the breadwinners and the protectors at home. This was a very real fear, and as a result of the fear, maybe some of the women were overstepping and seeking to control their husbands. It can be a dreadfully, dreadfully fearful thing to be called, to be subject to someone who is sinful. To follow someone who is deeply flawed. And again, some of you out there are thinking, amen! But God says, you must not fear. Trust God. The famous Proverbs 31, verse 30 says, charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord is to be praised. Trust God. Fear God. Follow Him. Be like Sarah, a woman of great faith, who feared the Lord and trusted the Lord. And if you do, you are her daughter. By walking in faith, you have a new family. And that faith family is called to help you and look after you in the case that a husband abandons you. We read all over the place in the New Testament about these situations. Women who are without their husband, who have been widowed, and the church is called to minister to them and look after them. Do not fear, Peter says. So we've seen that a wife shows her submission to God through her submission to her own husband. And that submission reveals itself in the ways we've just seen. A wife not seeking to prevail upon her husband with her words. A wife who focuses on inner beauty and through not fearing but trusting the Lord. These are the few nuggets that Peter shows us in this passage here. And again, even though there were cultural realities at work in this passage that perhaps prompted Peter to write, especially, like I said, many women were with husbands who did not believe, the truths that are presented here are consistent throughout all of Scripture. So this is more than just a cultural phenomenon. These are rooted in the nature of God and many other things. And we see these commands throughout the New Testament. So don't dismiss it as, well, I'm not in that position. And write it off, I don't have to submit, or I don't have to. As we'll see, men, there are things for you to do as well that you cannot just dismiss because of cultural arguments. All right, so now to the husbands. Very quickly, I'm going to fly through this with the husbands here, okay? Again, Peter gives less time to the husbands. I'm going to give less time to the husbands, but still got four big points, okay? So hang in there. Point number one for the husbands. A husband reflects that he's under God's authority when he lives with his wife in an understanding way. Again, this is just right out of the passage, okay? He lives with his wife in an understanding way. The first half of verse 7, likewise, husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel. The verse shows us that a man is to live with his wife, literally, live with. Now, some men travel for work, and I understand that is necessary at times, and I travel a fair amount myself, but work should not be so in focus for a man that he neglects his wife. Brothers, if you are married, you need to be with your wives as much as possible on a regular basis. Love her. Spend time with her. Walk with her. Serve her. Be with her. Okay? How can you live with your wife or lead your wife in an understanding way if you don't spend time with her? You can't understand your wife if you are not with her. When Peter says that a woman here is the weaker vessel, he probably means that the woman is physically weaker. Of course, there are exceptions. Some of you ladies out there could beat your husbands up, probably. But generally speaking, this is true, right? Generally speaking. His point is that while women may be tempted to influence their husbands through words, right? That might be the choice tool of wrestling that a woman would use with her husband, would be her words. Generally speaking, again, men may be tempted to use their superior strength and size to threaten or control their wives. Right? This would be, perhaps, in some cases, a man's temptation. This is ungodly and unacceptable in the sight of God. Which leads us to point number two for you husbands. A husband reflects that he is under God's authority when he gives his wife no reason to be afraid of him. No reason to be afraid of him. Brothers, let us not in any way intimidate our wives. Our strength should be used to honor them, as Peter says here, to build them up, to edify them, to bless them, to serve them. Give your wife no reason to fear you, brothers. Point number three for the husbands. The husband reflects that he is under God's authority when he loves in his wife the things that God loves in her. Notice in verse 4 those words, which in God's sight is very precious, speaking of that beauty, that inner beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit. Brothers, your wife is not a trophy. She might be very pretty. She's not a trophy. She is certainly a lot prettier than you are, let me say that. But she is more than her beauty. Proverbs 31, 10 and 11 say this, an excellent wife who can find, she is far more precious than jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. Husbands, celebrate all that your wife is and encourage those things in her which the Lord delights in. Don't only compliment her when she gets dolled up, but when you see that inner beauty that Peter speaks of, acknowledge it and give thanks to God for those things. Now for our final point. Point number four for you husbands. A husband reflects that he is under God's authority when he acknowledges his wife as a co-heir to the grace of life. Man and woman in marriage, this institution was given to us by God to be a mini parable of the good news that Jesus Christ loves sinners and gave himself for them. Husbands, your wife was so precious to God that he sent Jesus for her. Let us treat them this way as co-heirs. Let our leadership and our love model for them the kind of love that Jesus has for them. 1 Peter 2, and this is the passage just before the one before us this morning, 21 to 25. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Brothers, if we live this way with our lives, God will be glorified and marriage will be lifted up, not as something to be avoided, like so many in our culture today, but as a gift and blessing to you and to your wives. Amen. Let's pray. God, as we turn to worship and to sing, all glory be to Christ. We know that is the great purpose of marriage, to bring you honor and praise and glory in so many different ways. I know this message is uncomfortable and hard, not an easy one to preach, but it is in your word. And I pray we would be faithful to see that this is not just random, arbitrary teaching, but Lord, that these structures, these things that you have put in place, this dynamic of authority and submission was given to us as a gift and blessing and is intended for human flourishing, for our flourishing in marriage. Let us, as husbands and wives, seek to honor and fulfill these commands, but only in your power and strength. We long to glorify you. Let all of our marriages as Christian brothers and sisters here bring honor and glory to you. And may all those who are single, those who long to be married, perhaps never have, set these things as their goals and desires for the one they would be with. We love you and we thank you. We lift all these things to you now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. In response to God's word, let's sing together, all glory be to Christ. Let's stand as we sing.
Living water sound.
Let's receive now together the blessing of God. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Bless you all for being here. Join us downstairs for some refreshments if you've got time.